So there are many data types in R. So up to now, what you have seen was always you created a variable and that variable had one value. That's not so interesting. It becomes a lot more interesting when you create a variable and that variable can hold multiple values. Then there's a big benefit in working with variables instead of working with the values themselves. It's much shorter and easier. So that's what we will be doing today. So, and the first type that can hold multiple values is a vector. So what is a vector? A vector is a row of data. So it can hold many values, as you can see here. And it can hold numbers, it can hold text, it can hold booleans. So what you put in is not so important, it doesn't matter, as long as every element in a vector is the same type. So it's all numbers, all text, all booleans. You can mix, but if you mix, then he's going to make everything a piece of text. So everything will become a text value. And that's often not what you want. Now, what is special about a vector? It can hold multiple values. How can you distinguish the values? You can distinguish based on their actual value, but that's not always straightforward. Here, for instance, you have three elements that have the value true. So if I ask you return the value true, it can be the first, the second, or the fourth. So a better way or a unique way to specify each element in a vector is by using its position in the vector. And position is also called the index of the element. For instance, here, number 4 has index 3 because it's the third element in the vector. Blue has index 1 because it's the first element in the vector. And false has index 3 because it's the third element in the vector. So a vector consists of multiple elements. All the elements are the same type and every element is defined by its index, its position in the vector. How can you create a vector? You can do that by using the C function, where C stands for combine. So C is a normal function in R, so it's always followed by the round brackets. Every function is. So what do you put inside the round brackets? What are the arguments? Well, all the values that you want to store in the vector. So the line of code that you see here on the slide will create a vector with these values. And just as always, the different arguments are separated by commas. I want to create a vector. To do this, I have to use the combine function. It's a function, so it's followed by round brackets. Inside the round brackets come the arguments, and all the arguments are separated by commas. That's what you see here. So this is going to create a vector. If I want to store that vector permanently in R, I have to make an assignment. So I have to save that vector in a variable. So I make a variable called x here by doing the assignment, and that x will become the vector that is created by doing the combine function. So when I run this, piece of code, you see here in my environment that variable x was created and it contains these values. So it's a vector that contains these values. What does this mean? It means it's a vector of numbers. So all the elements of x are numerical. That's what it stands for. And there are 5 different values in x. So there are 5 elements in x. That's what the 1 to 5 means. So it's a vector containing numbers with 5 elements. Since this is such a small name for a function, just C, in the beginning you often forget it. So when you run this, you see that this doesn't work. It will give you an error. So you have to write the C for combine. So you can make a vector with numbers, but you can also make a vector with text. Remember, text values have to be inside quotes. So when I run this, I get a vector with text values. So this is what it looks like in the console. I can make a vector of booleans. And if I make a vector with elements of different types, so you have an integer here, you have a floating point number here, you have a boolean and you have a piece of text. So when I run this, you see what he does? He transforms everything into text. So this is no longer a boolean, but now it's an actual text with value true. And this is no longer an integer, but it's a text with value 1. I can make a second vector here, so I'm going to make a variable y that contains these two values by using the combine function. You see it popping up in the environment now. So as an input, as an argument for the combine function, you can define the actual elements like you do here or here. But you can also use vectors as arguments for the combine function. So this will combine the elements of vector x and the elements of vector y in one big vector. So when I run this, I get a vector with 7 elements. The elements from x, they come first, and then the elements from y. So the combine function can be used to create vectors. Now there are many other functions that you can use to create vectors. And I will go over the main ones because you often use them when you work in R. So one that is very heavily used is this one, the colon. So what does a colon do? It will create a vector of consecutive integers. I will show. So I'm creating a variable x1 here, and this is a vector that contains integers. Yeah. What integers? Well, consecutive integers, starting at 1 and ending with 4. So you get 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is typically used to create IDs for your data. Another one that you sometimes use is the sequence function. So let's take a look in the documentation. So SEG stands for sequence generation. So it generates a vector of numbers. That's basically what it does, a sequence of numbers. And you see here that it has many arguments. Yeah. So let's take a look at the first line. So the from and the to argument, let's take a look what they mean. So it's the start value of the sequence and the end value of the sequence. So you're going to make a sequence of numbers starting at 1 and ending at 2. And then the by argument, what is this thing? That's the increment of the sequence. So when I run this, I start at 1 because the from argument is equal to 1. And then the increment is 0.4, so I'm going to add each time 0.4 to the previous element in the sequence. And I'm going to stop when I reach 2. So the next one would be 2.2, that's more than 2, so he's stopping here at 1.8. Because the 2 argument was equal to 2. Alternatively, you can make a sequence like this, with from and to, but by specifying the length.out argument. So let's take a look. What's this? It's the length of the sequence. So the number of elements in the sequence, in the vector. So when you run this, you get this. So you start at 2, because the from argument is 2. You end at 3, because the 2 argument is 3. And then length is 5, so you need to create 5 elements in this vector. And he's going to create it in such a way that you have the same increment between every element. What you also use very often is this one, the rep function. And that stands for replicate or repeat. It just has a few arguments, not much as you can see. So the first argument is x. What is x? It's what you want to repeat. And then you have the times argument. And that is the number of times you want to repeat it. So this will repeat 2, 3 times. So when I run this, I get a vector like this, with 3 times 2. There is one more that I want to show you, and this is how to make a vector with random numbers. You also need that very often. Either you need random numbers, or you want to set the elements of another vector or the rows of a table in a random order. In both cases, you need to do a randomization. How can you do that? Different ways. The first one that I want to show is this one, the rnorm function. It stands for a random normal function. So what will it do? It will create a vector with random numbers from a normal distribution. So it has these arguments. So n is the number of elements in your random vector. And these two arguments are related to the normal distribution. So by default, it will create a vector with random numbers from a standard normal distribution, with mean 0 and a standard deviation of 1. That means that numbers close to 0 will have a higher chance of occurring, and the further you go away from 0, the less likely it will be that you will get numbers there. So as an example here, I'm going to create a vector with 50 random numbers from a normal distribution with mean 50 and standard deviation 20. So when I run this, I get, as you can see here, a set of 50 random numbers. Sometimes you don't want numbers from a normal distribution, but you want to have the same likelihood for every number to occur. If that's the case, then you need this one. The random numbers from a uniform distribution. So n defines how many elements you want, and then min and max define what the smallest and what the highest number can be. So when I run this, I'm going to create a vector with 10 random numbers from a uniform distribution. The smallest is 2, the highest is 100. So when I run this, I get a vector with 10 random numbers. So that's specifically when you want to draw from a certain distribution. Now, very often you have your own special set of numbers that you want, or numbers or items that you want to choose from. That's also possible, but for doing that, you need the sample function. This is the most general of these functions. It's the most versatile. So how does this one work? So it creates a random sample. And it has a few arguments. So the input is a vector or a set of elements that you want to choose from. The size is how many elements you want in the vector. And then you also have the replace argument that defines whether if he picked one of the elements from the vector, from the input vector, from x, if he picked one of the elements, should he put it back in x or should he remove it? So you see that by default, he's not doing any replacement. So if he picks an element from x, it's gone from x. So, and with sample, you can do a lot of fun stuff. For instance, I made a vector with colors. That's my input. So I'm going to pick colors from this vector. How many? Five. Five is more than the number of columns that I have, so I have to set replaces true. So I can pick red five times if I want to. So let's run this sample function, and this is the result. So he randomly picks a color from this list five times, just like you asked him. Suppose that I have a vector with 15 elements and I want to put them in random order, or I have a table with 15 rows and I want to randomize them. How can I do this? Well, same thing, sample. So what do you sample from this time? You sample from this vector. Remember, a colon creates a vector with consecutive integers. So these are the numbers of the rows in your table. This is row 1, this is row 15. So you're going to randomize this order. How? By setting size equal to 15, you're going to pick randomly 15 items from this vector without replacement. Because you're not specifying replace here, which means that you're going to go for the default value for replace, which is false. So this sample will create a random order in your 15 numbers. Suppose I want to have 10 random zeros and ones. What do I need to do then? Again, sample. Sample from what? Well, the only values that I want to pick is 0 and 1. So I create a vector with 0 and 1. I'm going to pick 10 times from that vector. That's the size argument. And I have to set replace to true. So when I do this, I get 10 random picks